years old. On the seashore, at a playground, in an ice cream store.
Were we ever introduced? Did Mama make me talk to you? Hey there, hello, hello, hello.
Love's far away, far away, but we're moving closer.
Praise God.
Amen.
Buona Afiwe.
Amen.
Thank you for coming. I am glad you came. And the reason why I am glad you came, it's not just because someone announced and made announcements, or because you have finished your exam, so you want to release or unleash. But it's because I know that you are going to benefit from these classes. I think this setting just takes me back to a few years ago, perhaps about 10 years ago, maybe 11, when I was a beneficiary of the teachings of Romans 101. Then we didn't even have a manual, or there was no organized class or session that you are having. I was a mere third year student who had found herself in a relationship. That just reminded me that was second year. So I found myself somewhere with the CU chairman. And I am glad, totally, forever grateful that I did those lessons. Because I am who I am today, and this family is as it is today, because the Lord helped us. The Lord guided us and helped us grow in purity, even as we related for those many years, which I hope you will not have. Yeah, so, and the Lord bless you even as you listen in. We pray that you will keep coming and keep being dedicated to these teachings even as we go through the sessions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So that's my beautiful wife. Carol, we've been married for, for the past 7 years. We do thank the Lord for His grace. We dated for a number of years before we were in a relationship, and we courted for a number of years before we, of course, got married. And we actually, as she was saying, were the first beneficiaries, I would say, of Romans 101, because we met Joni and Maggie, who's the author of this manual, in 2007, actually in November. We started our relationship in the morning of 20th of May, 2007. You didn't hear the year 2006, that's 12 years ago. And then, let me tell you why it was in the morning. It was in the morning because on the 19th, it was a Friday, you can check up your calendar. On the 19th of May, we had a Kesha. In campus, J-Court. And both of us attended the Kesha. In campus. And shall I tell you, the Lord spoke. And, in the morning before we slept, lest you sleep and you forget. Anyway, before we slept, we had a walk and we decided we in this, let's walk together. We've been walking together. Been the best gift that God will grace this feeble man with. I had someone say today that behind every great and successful man is a surprised woman. You know, because the woman knows you at home, and Ashanga, you've risen, or you are this kind of guy, and I know you at home. But God has been faithful. God has blessed us with two children, visible ones, Yanni, one of them. There is the felt and the seal. Yeah, and we thank the Lord for that. We are glad, as she was saying, we are glad to be here for Romance 1-1. We've been in KU before, but not at this level. So we are exceeding. We are extremely glad to be here before. Thank you for your commitment, for coming to invest in your life, in your marriage, in your relationship. It speaks for something, and may God honor your commitment and bless you for showing up and for coming. Amen.
Amen.
So this is what we will do. We do not have a very long time to be here. So for the next couple of minutes, say an hour plus or minus a few minutes, we'll do a small discussion. I'll ask those of us who are close up and who the mic can get to be as bold as possible. We'll take a couple of questions in form of a discussion, and then we'll go to our lesson for today. And then we'll do some housekeeping, because this is the first lesson that we're having for Masoma. We'll do together for the next 10 weeks. So we'll do some housekeeping and do some administrative stuff in terms of announcements and what's available at the very end of the lesson. That sounds like a plan,
yeah?
So we can begin with the lesson. So we'll start with a discussion. And I'll ask you a couple of questions. Number one, do you have a place to write? Most of us have, that's a good thing. So you can jot down. The reason why we are asking is to show us where we're coming from, where we are at, and where we are headed. So I'll ask you to cooperate as much as possible, eh? And we don't have time, so it's like a speed test. Make sure you engage your mind, you engage your neighbor, you engage your thoughts and your memories as much as possible. So write down three things you love about the family you grew up in. So think through. Think when you are five, if you can remember, you know, when you were in your childhood, so to speak, when you were in your teenage and your father started giving you some autonomy and some decision-making abilities, and now when you are in your adulthood, but still living in your parents' house, if you do, I mean, you still report to your parents and accountable to them. So think through about the family that you came from, or you know, your parents, your guardians, your relatives, wherever family you came from somewhere. Think through, what things do you love about that family? And then I'll ask, I really hope we'll get some bold guys. So we'll get, because of time, just two answers from the floor. Anyone who's bold, you can either shout or pick up a mic and give us an answer. If you don't, of course, I'll pick you up. So sizing down, all of a sudden, eye contact him. Imekatika. So anyone who's finished and clearly remembers something they love about their father? Great, that's good. You can shout.
They care.
They care. You can be more granular in your response. Give an example. Why do you say they care? That's a good response. I mean, but why? Yeah.
So
granular. With my two bad exams in Malaysia, I was to be here for exam.
So, yeah, for some, every now and then they're asking how you're doing.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay, so they keep finding out how you're doing. That, so they express their caringness and their love that way. That's good. See, you know, like, well, my dad showed me love in a different way. Remember, I mean, it's African families, when you get into the house, or when your dad, of course, your dad will find you into the house, and the first thing they will ask is, umekula! And that's their way of saying, I love you, my son. Because I care about you. And your mom would say, ungalia kama yuko inakutosha. Or your dad will give you a kaibu, na kuambia uchore yako mguu, atakuambia kiatu that never comes. It's a way of showing, they love you, and they care. Anyone else is bold? Great. Unity. There is unity in the family. What makes you say there is unity? What will you do differently from your parents in your old family? So we'll take a shorter time on that one because it seems there are many things you will do differently. So what will you do differently in your own family? In other words, what didn't you like much? What would you want to change? What do you think would have been improved given the opportunity? What did you do differently from your parents? Our index one wants to answer again. To Patel. Okay, so. Index one, big granular, remember? Many universities, we've never had such a response. anyone else? Now a lady. Okay. So it's okay. Another man wants to answer, then we'll get a lady.
I'm also not a lady.
Yes. So you have a closer relationship with your kids. That's good. Even your point is good. I'm sure you've heard this before. The men who say, "I told you I love you" on our wedding day. If anything changes, I'll let you know. So we be expressive in our love. Those are good points and fair points. Think through, because the point is we all come from somewhere else. No, we all come from families. We get into relationships as two very separate and autonomous individuals, and we have a background that we are coming with, and that plays out in the context of our relationship and of our marriage. And the more we think about them, the more clear we are about them, the better our relationship will be. Moving on, I'll be faster in the rest of the questions. So name a couple you think are really enjoying marriage. And two indicators. Now there's a rider to this question. Don't name your pastor. Don't name your pastor. I'm not saying pastors don't enjoy their marriages, not at all. I'm just putting them out of the list. Because they have to, many times, they have to play the part. They have to come to church, they have to sit together. So, out of the list, any other couples that you think are really enjoying their marriage? And what makes you think that? Keep doing it.
Sometimes
You are. Teacher.
Yes.
Mr. and Mrs.
Mr. and Mrs. Lamakwa.
Okay. Who are they?
They are my mentors.
Okay. Hey. So we married for how long?
7 years.
7 years. Oh, they are very good. What makes you think they enjoy their marriage?
How they do things. Like... Oh, my God.
Very good. Who are they?
They are my parents.
So why?
Why have been married for 25 years.
Wow. 25.
Yes. And growing up, it's because of people a bit, it's a few times I've seen them. I've been given success. And they have solved them well.
Okay.
And they have really brought us up in a good way. Though some of us, not me.
We are talking about your parents, not
they brought us up well. Okay. They introduced us to the church.
Okay.
Yes, gave us a way to know the Lord. Like, the church. And just making this dog, it's
so, that's an excellent. Isn't that, I guess, it's probably the place where we all want to be, yeah? Where away from home, many years from now, someone asks my kid, my two boys, my two boys and their sister, and they say that they really admire their parents. That's a good thing. Now, moving on. It is only about ventures. So, how many relationships have you had since conversion? No, anyone can answer. But the purpose of this question is we need to, I think, have candid conversations. An environment needs to be candid and homely, and a place where we can open up our hearts if you are bold enough. And help us now. So if there's any one bold soul in this room, index one or put up a couple of two. Index one and follow it. Any one bold soul in this room? To answer that question, how many relationships have you had? Anyway, all of us are answering these questions, isn't it? You are writing it down. So write it down, first of all. Okay, you can do a mental writer, but write it as how many relationships have you had since your conversion, since you got converted. For some, it may be a relevant question, that's why we're here. Listen, how many relationships do you have currently? How many relationships have you had since you got converted? So anyone? Let's start. Help us. You that you are
phone or near your siblings. And you're saying those some of us do not me.
Excuse my compassion. Yeah. I've had one. And right now I have zero.
The other question is also relevant. If not the first one, give three reasons for the breakup. If not the first one, three reasons for the breakup. Okay, this one, if you were Kungojiaba, answer just the first question. Let me spare you. How many romantic relationships have you had since your breakup? One. It's current.
No.
Yeah.
Church and finance. Yeah. I'm a principal person.
So, the first bit of the discussion, I wish you could have more time. If you could just find out what your experience is and see where we are at, as many as we are. So let's have one meeting. So the first group of the questions will, in a way, show us where we are at. With respect to our context, our families, etc. The second group of the questions will come closer home to our one view of romantic relationships, of courtships, of dating, of marriage, so to speak. And so it brings the question closer home. And so I was not asking to expose anyone. I was asking to help us know where we are at in terms of our thinking towards romantic relationships. And so the first lesson of Romance 101, that's Romance 101, and that's why we are here, is why biblical foundation. So we talk about biblical foundations as a premise to romantic relationships. Okay? And so today I will build a case on why this is our first topic and why we ought to pay particular attention to biblical foundations with respect to our romantic relationships. And give us five quick reasons why biblical foundations are important. So we start with the first session of why biblical foundations. Number one. Your romantic relationships is arguably one of the strongest evidence of your encounter with the gospel. Think about it. What does the gospel do to us? Christ picked a couple of things. And he talks about when it will be a stretch of interpretation, but it would follow. I'll come to it later when we're talking about marriage and divorce. I'll give you an example of Christ taking a common thing and, in a way, showing that a person has been converted through it. Zacchaeus is on top of a tree, wanting to see Jesus. And you know his famous confession, he says, whatever I have, I'll give to the poor. Whatever I've stolen, I'll give four times of what I've stolen and give it back. The response of Christ is, today, salvation has come to the house of this man, to the heart of this man. Why? Because he's taken a secular thing, money, and in a way it has affected his life and it has moved into action. Now, we have many people in church today, many people in Christian unions, many people in youth fellowships who say they are born again. But if you are to look at their romantic relationships, independent of their confession of being born again, you will not see any trace of the gospel in their relationships. And so what I'm saying is, how you handle your romantic relationship will tell any independent onlooker or any independent investigator whether or not you are truly converted. For instance, the gospel delivers us from the bondage of sin. But we have not in a condemning anyone. But you have people in church today who are walking in bondage and in sin in their romantic relationships, and they're born again. Okay? Two, the gospel empowers us by the grace of God not to live for ourselves, not to live selfish lives, but in a way to have the interests of others way above our interests. But we have people in romantic relationships who are selfish to the core. I had a preacher, this is a true story, he's been married for 50 years. And so they were, it's a panel of sorts. seated with a wife or in front of a congregation, and the person leading the discussion asked the wife, how have you managed, what's the secret of 25 or 50 years of marriage? And the wife, without missing a beat, says, both of us have been in love with the same man. And that sounds like a very spiritual answer. So both of us have been in love with the same man. The congregation will think both of us have been in love with Jesus. And so that has been the secret of their marriage. But the preacher was saying that it's David Pawson. So both of them laughed. And when they went outside, David said, I think I'm the only one in that room who understood what you said. That both of us are in love with David. That David loves himself, and the wife loves himself. That in a way, he's acknowledging that he's been selfish. It was a light note. But we have people who are in relationships and in marriages, but somehow have never lost the grip of loving themselves, or I'm saying you don't love yourself, or of being selfish or self-centered. That's the point I'm trying. The gospel gives you grace not to look at yourself and your interests and your needs beyond the interests of others. If you're in a romantic relationship and that is what you do, then somehow the gospel is not affecting your life. Okay. So how you handle your romantic relationships, tell us what sort of a person you are with respect to the gospel. So it also teaches us to love graciously. That talks of selfishness as well. And it demonstrates the permanence of the union with Christ, of Christ and the church. That's the gospel. So, no, there are Christian unions where being in a relationship is a taboo. I'm not sure if this is one of them. Where I was in Christian union, where we say there was a chairman. And, in fact, we were in the relating, and the chairman still. And we deliberately made it a public relationship. And we opened up ourselves to scrutiny. Not because we were perfect, far be it from that. But in a way, if through our weaknesses and our strengths, someone will be strengthened, then the name of the Lord be glorified. And if guys will look at your relationship, you that say that I'm born again and cannot trust the gospel, then you need to rethink of your relationship. But if someone will look at you and your relationship and see the marks of a converted soul, praise be to God. Amen. So the gospel must affect the very core of your being. It must affect your wallet, must affect your heart, must affect you. Yeah. Number two. While we are advocating for, I'm trying to rush through, for biblical foundation, is because of the rise of dysfunctional homes that we are seeing now. The statistics are shocking. I will not go through them now, but many of us, even in this room, come from families that are either, what he was saying should be the ideal and should be the norm, but it's the exception. Unfortunately, that we come from families that are dysfunctional, families that have been broken. If not, we know people we know our neighbors, our relatives, our friends who are coming from dysfunctional homes. And why we are here is that we, in a way, want to affect a generation that we will build different families from the ones that we are seeing around us. Families that truly honor the Lord, families that honor whatever is taught in the Bible with respect to relationships and marriage. Okay? So we want to be different. We want you to be different. We want you to be beacons of change and hope in our generation because of what you are seeing around and the hurt and the pain that you are seeing around arising from dysfunctional homes and dysfunctional families. Before I move to true greatness, let me juxtapose this with a different point. And I'll try to be as brief as possible on this one. Marriage is meant to be permanent.
Okay. In our context today, where the church is running towards an exception that was given by Christ with respect to divorce and remarriage after divorce, is not biblical, and I dare say, is not the correct interpretation of Scripture. Now, don't lose me. Look at Scripture. Point number three, the permanence of marriage. What did God say about marriage? I ask myself. What did Moses say about marriage? What did the prophet say about marriage? What did the scribes between that silent period say about marriage? What did Christ say about marriage? God spoke about marriage in many instances, but let me speak of two. Number one, in Genesis chapter 2, marriage was meant to be permanent. It says 24, and for this reason, etc. You know the verse. It was meant to be heterosexual, number one. I say this because of our generation. It was meant to be monogamous, and it was meant to be, most importantly, it was meant to be permanent. They will cleave. It's like glue, putting glue together. They will cleave one to another. It was meant to be permanent. Okay? So I seek to ride on that command. The second thing that God says about marriage in terms of chronology would be on the seventh commandment, where he says adultery is a sin. Thou shalt not commit adultery. It's a command of respect. You will honor your wife. You will honor your marriage bed. You will not commit adultery. Okay? So it's a sin only for the married people. Okay. Now that seems obvious, but it has great repercussions when you go to the New Testament on what Jesus talked about marriage. I'll come to it in a moment. Now, Moses says in Deuteronomy 24, follow me, says in Deuteronomy 24, gives in his law, the law of Moses, that a man can divorce his wife for two reasons. One, and listen to him, and if the wife does anything the man dislikes, okay? We know not what the indecent thing is. In fact, it was subject to interpretation and biblical discourse and arguments when the times came in the sea after my life. But am I under the law of Moses? No. Okay. Now, moving into the prophets. And the prophets, Hosea is probably one of the most beautiful books with respect to marriage. Read it in one sitting, you'll like it and you'll love it. But he gives a picture of what he feels about Israel and Hosea. And follow me. Follow this argument. And then he speaks through Jeremiah and talks to Israel. In fact, Jeremiah chapter 8 says, I have divorced you. And someone may claim on that and says, if God can divorce Israel, then I can divorce my wife. That's not the case, because later on he says, I will bring her back. Okay? And I will do to Israel what Hosea was meant to do to the wife. I will buy her back, I will discipline her, I will forgive her, and I will love her. And then, that's the prophets. The scribes had a different argument that I do not have time to go to. Jesus speaks about divorce on three gospels. Okay? Luke and Mark, and then Matthew. He gives an explanation of his view of divorce in all of them, but mainly in Luke and Mark. And this is what he says. He says, if you leave your wife and marry, you commit adultery. Okay? And then he says, this is the explanation he gives. And then he says, if anyone marries a divorcee, he also commits adultery. Okay? If you forget anything, remember this. His explanation and his exception. And then he says, are you following? If you leave and marry and remarry, you commit adultery. If you marry a divorcee, you commit adultery. So, according to Jesus, he is against divorce. He is for the permanence of marriage. Okay? So he's speaking in the Gospel of Mark and the Gospel of Luke. In the Gospel of Matthew, he says the same thing, but he gives an exception. Now, in church, people run to the exception and they forget the explanation. Okay? The exception is an exception because it is not the norm. Isn't it? Now, I have my Bible here, but I wish I could read it. So in Matthew, he says, Matthew should be either chapter 5 or chapter 7. It speaks about marriage and divorce and remarriage after that. He omits it in Matthew, and then he says, except for this reason. And the reason he gives is what? Is adultery. Now, I am very sorry if this sounds like a theological lesson, but the words that Christ uses are different. The word for adultery in Greek is different from the word that he used in Matthew chapter, should be chapter 7. You can check it out. The word that he uses as, if you don't believe me, Google it. Get a Greek word. The word is pornai. Okay, if you have ESOD, you can check. And that word would have different interpretations. I don't have time to go to them. But in the context, the correct interpretation was fornication. And why Christ gives that exception in the book of Matthew alone is this, listen to me, is because the first audience in the book of Matthew were what? The Jewish people. Okay? So no wonder that, for instance, I'll give you an example. Matthew never says the kingdom of God. Okay? Matthew says the kingdom of heaven. Because I know time is up. Says the kingdom of heaven. Why does he say the kingdom of heaven? Because the Jewish mind or the Jewish mouth could not freely utter God. Okay. Then he many times says, so that the prophecies may be fulfilled. They're talking to the Jewish audience, okay? The Jewish culture was similar to his earthly father and Mary, that they, between the period of betrothal, it was so serious that if they would leave at that time, it would be termed as divorce. So when Christ says, you should not divorce except for adultery, the right word is fornication, I believe he was speaking for that period. That period where you're betrothed in the Jewish culture, and if someone commits fornication at that particular time when you're not married, but you're betrothed, then at that point you're allowed to divorce. What is the implication of what I'm trying to say? In scripture, the correct interpretation, in my view, is that there is no reason given for divorce. The example that Christ gives is in, read it for interpretation, and think about it, John chapter 4 and John chapter 8, incidentally speaking to two women. The woman at the well, and the woman who was caught in the very act of adultery. Okay. So now, when Christ says, if you leave your husband or wife and remarry, you commit adultery, what is the implication? The implication is, in the eyes of God, divorce is invalid. That divorce never ends a marriage in the eyes of God. Only death does. No, remember when I said that adultery is a sin for who? For married people. Are you getting that? It's a sin for married people. Now, you have divorced your wife, you've remarried someone else, and Christ says you have committed adultery. Why? What's the implication? The implication is you are still married. Isn't it?
Because it's a sin for who? Married people. So according to Christ and according to scripture, which is our precedent, nothing apart from death ends marriage. But we have churches that have pastors who are on their bad marriages. We do. Okay. Precedence and what people do is not, we cannot justify actions. No matter how spiritual you are, we cannot justify actions that are outside of scripture. And so why we speak of biblical foundations is because marriage is permanent. If someone told you today that the first car you will buy, you will stay with it until you're 50, 60, 70, 80 years, your first car is permanent, wouldn't you be careful on the car that you buy? No, I have nothing against. But if it was a permanent decision, then you would think through before you make that decision, isn't it? So marriage is permanent. Why we need biblical foundations is because marriage is permanent according to scripture. Okay. So the context we are growing up in, our society, whatever you're seeing in churches, it will not form a basis of our decision as a generation. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Let me rush through this. I promise you, I'll be very quick. Okay. Number four is that the measure of true greatness, that if God wants to bless you and me, the measure of true greatness is through your generation, your families. In other words, if God wants to bless you immeasurably, He will bless your generations. Okay? So we have example, two good examples. We have Abraham, who was given a blessing, yes, in his lifetime. But his blessing was also tied to his generations. Little wonder the Messiah came through him. Another person whose lineage was the Messiah is David. David is actually told expressly in 2 Samuel chapter 7 verse 12 that when you die, it's after you are born. After you are born, when you die, in your generations, then I will bless you. I will say that the United States, first I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. So his blessing was tied to his generation. And so if God would bless me, or bless you immeasurably, it will come through your generations. Okay? And so if that would be the case, then I cannot be casual about the person I choose to be my wife. I'd better do it after a Kesha. Anyway. You need to do that. But in other words, I'll not be casual about the choice I make of my wife and my husband, because I know the true greatness of a man comes through his generation. It's an illustration of Mark Jukes and Jonathan Edwards. I won't go that because of time. The fifth reason is because I'll only say a sentence of that is because my marriage, my relationship is a picture of Christ and his church. Okay, so I will not be casual about my romantic relationship. Why? Because the world is watching. And whatever the world sees in me is meant to picture and mirror what Christ is to his church. I'm on the slide of why romance on one. Yeah. Don't worry, I'm going to use it in the next half minute. No, less than 5 minutes. So why romance on one? This is why we do these classes. For the next 9 or so weeks, we aim and desire and purpose to provide a biblical, so we'll, whatever we teach, may God help us that it will not be our human reason. So a biblical, comprehensive, contextual, and localized guide on romantic relationship for who will be couples. That's why we're here. That we'll do it biblically, it will be comprehensive, we'll work with our context, and we'll localize whatever we have as much as possible for you, for your life, and for the glory and advancement.
Could have known that we find each other.